21 years ago, it was rolled over Beethoven and shove off Shostakovich. On the airwaves, at least.
Radio 2, Radio 1, go.
Yes, 1967, and Britain gets its chance to tune in to the first ever national radio station devoted exclusively to pop music. Isn't that so, Tony?
And good morning, everyone. Welcome to the exciting new sound of Radio 1.
On hand were the new style disc jockeys, eager to get down, get on it, and move with the groove for the nation's edification. And there are certainly no shortage. In fact, here's one young fella who's absolutely lapping it up. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing, of course. But luckily, there was no shortage of chaps like young Dave Cashier, eager to rip it up, whip it up, and rock and roll all night long. Well, until 7:30 at least, at which time the frequency reverts to the light programme. And here's a glimpse of the sort of chaps we're going to be hearing from in the future, providing they last that long, of course. This sort of music isn't to everyone's taste, of course. In fact, some might ask you to jolly well put a song in it. And that goes for the people who listen to it too. Isn't that so, Mrs. Potts?
Do you see these people with flowers in their hair? All ridiculous.
Perhaps so, Mrs. Potts. But in the meantime, the watchword is go, man, go, and just watch those hepcats swing on this, Britain's first ever national pop station.
Good time music. Right!
8 o'clock, and Simon Bates is already at work finding out what's been happening in the world of entertainment whilst the rest of us were asleep.
I'm probably the luckiest disc jockey on Radio 1 because I miss the rush hour. I come in before the rush hour starts in central London, and then read the papers, and then start making phone calls. And I find with public relations people and promoters and the kind of people who manage pop groups, if you catch them at home before they've had a shave and a cup of coffee or before they've gone out to work, they'll very often tell you what's going on and then think about it later and say, why did I tell Simon Bates that?
And those will give us access to backstage all the way through. Is that right?
It's sure. Very much a 24-hour thing. If I get a phone call at 3 o'clock in the morning from America at home, the one thing I don't do is object to it. Feedback from the public is absolutely vital. I mean, there are eyes, ears, nose and throat in every sense. We get it through road shows, through outside broadcasts, when we actually meet people. You also get phone calls, inevitably, from the public, and they can ring in whenever they want to. I'm delighted to hear from them. And letters. Letters aren't always complimentary. The complimentary ones are lovely. The ones that say, for heaven's sake, Batesy, pull yourself together, those are the ones that are usually useful. And we are accused occasionally of being out of touch because we broadcast from London. That's the reason we do the outside broadcasts. That's the reason that they're an integral part of our policy. And I think that's the reason as well that we do, for example, the discos that we do and the charity fundraising events, because it's very important to get disc jockeys and engineering staff and executives down and up to all the parts of the country and to make sure that we're all seen and that we all communicate with the different areas of Great Britain. I like outside broadcasts that have a reason and a purpose. I like going from A to B, which we did with the bed push, which we did with the canal trip that we did. I like an outside broadcast that has a reason. The Roadshow is a good example of a broadcast that has a reason.
The Radio 1 Roadshow is 15 years old now and has become something of an institution in its own right. Every year it travels to 45 resorts, playing now to a staggering 500,000 people. 10 million visitors since it started, and it's a lot of fun. But don't just take my word for it.
Guys and girls, now then, here we are with Mr. Stephen Wright, very super, super guy. Now then, on the Radio 1 Roadshow, don't you love him to death, guys and girls? Now then.
Roadshows are quite different from studio work because you've got the audience right in front of you and you have to go out there and generate that kind of enthusiasm amongst, say, up to 2,000 people sometimes, even more. The idea of the roadshow is like kind of a circus. The circus comes to town. It's exciting. The roadshow is brilliant.
Radio 1 Roadshow.
Wow.
What is nice about road shows or going out and doing gigs or any personal appearance is that you know if things are working on the air or not. You can see the response to what you're doing on the air, and when you go out, you're confronted by the listener right in front of you. He or she is just a foot away from you. So that's great. That's great. That's what you want. It's how you really find out. It's the ultimate research.
That's the problem. Here we go. Excuse me. Hey, what's your problem? Stop doing that.
Simon always says you could stick a twig up there and get the twig to put on the headphones and do the roadshow. It isn't the personality that they flock to. It's the fact that it's the Radio 1 roadshow and it's legendary. And it kind of runs itself.
Who's the impressionist? Where?
What are you doing wearing white socks?
Excuse me? Excuse me? Oh, look, we have a lofty lookalike here. Yeah, that's right, Steve, yeah.
You have to be a lot more animated than you would normally be. You have to extend your personality a little bit more. But it's fun to do, and we always come up with a new game. You know, we have the boiling oil one year, and we have Gaylord the Gorilla, or we always think of some kind of zany game, something unusual, a little bit bizarre, to do on stage so that it becomes memorable.
Meet some of these audiences like you do on the roadshow, 25,000 people at a time, is quite incredible. And I really enjoy it, I really do, because so many people turn up and they really are with you. Every single one of those people down there are fans of Radio 1. They like what we do, they like everything about it, and they go bananas. It's just brilliant. I mean, we go all around the country, mainly just turn up really and do a few competitions and get the audience going, etc., etc., and put all the tricks out of the bag.
Right. Who recorded the first one as the winner? Who recorded The Look of Love? ABC. ABC is right, so that's Dave, he's the winner. Give a nice round of applause. Well done, Dave.
Roadshows are a heck of a lot of fun. I mean, it's something that we all look forward to getting out, because it's rather like a school trip. You know, you look forward to the 1 or 2 weeks out that you get every year, and it's like being part of a travelling circus as well, because I mean, you just move in one huge convoy from resort to resort. I've never played a record on a Radio 1 roadshow. I refuse to do it. I'm on the front of the stage just having fun with the crowd the whole time. So even whilst the records are playing, I'm whooping the atmosphere up and having a laugh. So that's great fun, really enjoy that. In programme terms, it's quite a tough show to do. It sounds very easy, but it's very tough because you have to convey all the atmosphere, because people are listening, can't actually see what's going on. But it is fun. I mean, I adore the roadshows, especially the warm-ups, the things that we get up to before we actually go on air, because we have a heck of a lot of fun. It's like doing a giant gig.
There he is, Radio 1's heartthrob, Gary Davis. The rest of us do our best to give satisfaction as well, you know. You're going to wear that pen out, Gary?
Yeah!
Say after me, we...
Absolutely brilliant. One of the nicest road shows I can ever remember doing in my life. It's been lovely. Thank you very much.